Ain't No Half Steppin' with Marcus J. We are back live in the den, legacyinternetradio.com. Appreciate everybody that's still with us. Call us up, be down. We're going another 30 minutes or so. I don't know anybody that thinks that we actually a 7 and 9 show. I can't remember the last time we went until 9. Maybe when we was on that website, we used to be. But we own this joint, y'all. So we staying here until we ready to be gone. But we're going to be here probably another half, a little over half hour. Ain't No Half Steppin' with Marcus J. Keeping with the what the hell things that's going on. I need to stand corrected, April and Carlton. And no disrespect to Stephen, hang tight, because this is pretty much for those of us who have kids right now. Particularly April, because you have a girl. I got a girl. And one of the people out there that my girl at one point was sweet on was a fella by the name of Justin Bieber. And I, you know, the whole Justin Bieber thing, it's highly annoying.
Like very.
You know, and I'm not even talking about like right now. I'm talking about like when he first came out, you know, the whole bubblegum thing. You know, I got it. I understood why the little girls liked him, but it just was annoying as hell to me until I took her to the movie. He had a little, you know, concert movie that came out a couple years ago. So I took her to the movie and I enjoyed the movie. Seriously, I enjoyed the movie. You know, he came across as a very nice kid, likable, handsome kid. I enjoyed it. I liked him. You know, I'm not going to download his music and be pumping it in the car, you know, but I didn't have no problem with Justin Bieber until recently. Just all of these things are starting to come out, you know, like he's speeding around the neighborhood. There was one speeding around the neighborhood. Keyshawn Johnson, NFL player, you know, is a neighbor of his. I had to pull him aside and be like, look, yeah, you need to chill.
Right.
You had a situation where he's at a restaurant and he's in the kitchen signing autographs, and then he goes and literally urinates in a mop bucket right there, and this video of it. I see him doing it, you know, and then, you know, the latest with him allegedly spitting on his fans, like spitting off a balcony, spitting on his fans. And so he has gotten the ire of Sharon Osbourne.
Mm-hmm.
Sharon Osbourne, you know, wife of Ozzy.
Right.
You know, mother of the
Kelly Jack.
And Jack and all that. And Sharon, we know, is on The View. Not The View, The Talk.
The Talk.
She's on The Talk, which I like better than The View, actually.
Yeah.
Sharon has said something that is very, very, very controversial. I'm getting this one from yourblackworld.net. And again, she's had a lot to say about the young 19-year-old Justin Bieber. And she trashed him after the star was found with Class C drug, marijuana, and paraphernalia on his tour bus traveling from Windsor, Canada to Detroit. Her remarks were hinting at a racist charge, stating that Justin's, quote, acting out is trying to portray the role of being black. Her actual quote is, I think that he's lost. I really do. I think he doesn't realize he's white and not black. That's a huge problem. And I think at this point in his career, it's so dangerous because we've seen it before a million times. I'm going to come to you on this one first, April. I'm not going to say my opinion yet. Give me your opinion.
I think it's ironic that she said that he's lost and he needs to realize he's white and not black. Because as you were running down his list of transgressions, I'm thinking Britney Spears, and she's not black.
Right.
So it's not about white or black. It's just going back to Johnny Manziel. We don't know what to do with our fame. We're not mature enough yet. Everything is cute. Everything is fun. You know, we forget there are cameras everywhere. Too much, too fast, too soon. No one saying pause, you know. I don't know if mom is still managing or if mom is around. You know, I don't even know how old Justin Bieber is.
He's
right
19.
Now. 19. Thank you.
Colin Banks, what's your thoughts on this, man?
I want to know what is acting black.
Personally. Well, that's the essence of what the question is about.
That's what I need her to answer that question for me. Because see, what people haven't done yet to that comment is put her in the Paula Deen category, because she's basically said it without saying it.
Okay.
So, you know, what is acting black? Just tell me.
Well, I disagree that she's in the Paula Deen category because she didn't say it.
She didn't. In your she's opinion, implying.
In your opinion, she basically said it. She's implying it, but she didn't say it. She didn't say the N-word, and that is the difference. The fact that, you know, Paula Deen said the N-word, and the way that Paula Deen was saying it, and the years of the, you know, oppressive practices that go beyond her use of that word. It's a huge difference between one and the other, in my opinion. But Steven, I'm going to get yours before I really get into mine. What's your opinion on this, Steven?
I hit where she's trying to get, but I'm going to throw another question back to answer it. How many times everybody, one of us, because we speak intelligently, we're told mm-hmm. we're acting white.
Right.
So although I did not care for how she put it, my thing is, until we in our community stop telling kids or people you're acting a certain way, so thus you're trying to be white, before we can do anything else, this is what we're going to get in result. So if we did not do this, picking around saying, telling people you're acting a certain thing versus accepting who you are, because a person may be just a personality of how you are.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I grew up in a hood, just that and the other, but I do not act what some may consider stereotypical. So mm-hmm. I'm told I'm acting white. So it's the same thing reversed. I think they picked up on that and reversed it. You know, they said the same thing about Vanilla Ice. They said right. the same thing about anybody else that may act like non-traditional. To his question about what is black, it's given this stereotype of the reckless, outrageous behavior that you see some of our rappers or other black celebrities that is reported on. Now, other celebrities do a whole lot of other things, in some cases worse. Mm-hmm. We can talk about the hair bands in the 80s, but that's not put into the same category as relentless
right.
as we are. You know, as soon as we do one thing wrong, and then it could be a whole bunch of things. And I think this points to how Usher is still managing him and mentoring him. And mm-hmm. he was doing similar things in his youth, and obviously he's not now, but it begs the question, what are you actually mentoring versus trying to make him an image of you?
I wouldn't bring Usher in because I disagree that Usher was doing them kind of things. Usher had his issues, but he wasn't wilding out
like
this.
No, not this bad.
He wasn't wilding out like this. My issue with Usher is I see him cuss his mama out. Once I saw that, I was mm-hmm. done with Usher. But I understand the spirit of what you're saying. But you got to also remember that the images that are portrayed are controlled by people who don't have our best interests at hand. And so when you continue to see on the evening news, you know, transgressions, you know, negative things portrayed by young black males, you know, that's going to lead to the brainwashing and the stereotyping. Are young black males out there wilding out? Of course they are. Are young white males out there wilding out? Of course
yes.
they are. You got to remember, you know, that people who control the image are going to always portray the other person in
right.
the worst light than
right.
themselves. And you got two people who commit a crime together, and one of them gets caught. What's he going to do? He's going to snitch on the other guy. That's just how it goes. Black folk don't own no record companies. Black folk don't own no TV stations. Black folk don't own no radio stations except for Big Ruben Marcus J. We own Legacy on that radio. But in all seriousness, and yes, we own a couple of record stations, record labels. Of course, I know that. But the point I'm making is the overall image that is portrayed, you know, is being put out there by people who don't have our best interests at hand. And so when we continue to feed into it and we continue to accept it and we continue to, you know, basically make their point, then mm-hmm. you have a situation where someone like, you know, Sharon Osbourne, keep in mind, she ain't from here. She's
right.
from another country. Now, I'm not going to justify her statement, you know, by saying that she's not from here, but she's not from here. So if all she sees when she turns on the TV is the negative images of black men wilding out, then, yeah, you got to think about it. When you watch television, right, for the sisters, what you see on TV as far as reality TV, you see Tammy Roman and you see NeNe Leakes and you see them wilding out and you see Flavor of Love where you got 15 girls trying to get with one guy, right? But then you watch the white folk with The Bachelor, you know, and it's flipped. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, you see these family-oriented shows with them, you know, but you see us throwing chairs, you know. And you got to remember that when you are, you know, putting your fingers in the face of someone that's saying these things, because it's the image. And once we decide that we're going to change the image and stop being so money-hungry, because these kids, they're kids. They kids, and they after that money.
You do, begging the question also, you got to consider, look at her husband, who was no saint himself. I think of Axl Rose.
That's true.
I think of a whole bunch of rockers. Even now, back now, you see a bunch of the pop bands. What are they doing? It's just now that they're being clean cut image. But we've heard the stories of all the women acting crazy, fighting police officers.
Right.
You know, Axl Rose is deemed a love beloved, but he was doing all these things and a heck of a lot worse.
Simone is listening to us. Thanks for listening, Simone. She's saying Justin Bieber is a kid, and the adults around him obviously are more interested in him making their money and, mm-hmm. and offer no guidance to him. It's not a race thing. It's a kid acting like a jerk, and the people around him supporting his negative behavior. I definitely agree
That's
with that.
That's true.
I definitely That's agree true. With that. But the essence of what I wanted to get into in this segment was the fact that she mm-hmm. said that him acting crazy suggest that he's trying to act black, and to me, there's so many tentacles to that statement, and there's so much brainwashing that's done, you know, to white people about black people, and even black people about black people, and instead, until people take the time to realize that black people, us, that our behavior, you know, feeds into that, it's a bigger picture. But and or those of us who are not those people stand up and say, you know what, I ain't watching Basketball Wives. How many right. people you think listening to Aint on Half Step with Marcus J right now? Not as many as tuned in to some kind of craziness that's on television that, you know, is basically adding to the stereotype mm-hmm. that adds to people like this who think the way they think. It's a thought process because it's a brainwash. Well, how many times you heard that song on the radio, You Can't Stand, but you heard it like 15 times a day? You know,
and you sang it in the shower.
And now you sing it in the shower. Like, I give you a perfect example. Like, that song that CeeLo Green did, Crazy. I used to hate that song.
Oh,
that
yeah.
That made me crazy. I used yeah. to hate that song. Until now, I got that joint, you know, on the MP3, and I listen to it, you know. So
it becomes a habit where you become numbed and nonchalant to certain things. I'll give you an example when a lot of people just, you beg for people to stop it, then when they watch it and over again, you just become numb to it. And now it's socially acceptable instead of saying it's wrong.
Aint no half stepping with Marcus J. I want to move on to the next story that I have. And this one is interesting. Harry Belafonte and Jay-Z are engaged in an intergenerational beef. I'm getting this from the NPR.org. I won't really read a lot of this article. I'll just kind of get into the story as I know it, and let's roundtable it. Basically, it started, and I did part of the story, you know, a few months ago when it first kind of came out. Basically, Harry Belafonte called out a lot of the entertainers and stars of today for not being as socially active as they were in his generation. In his criticism, he specifically labeled Jay-Z and Beyonce. Jay-Z, of course, took exception to that, which started their little beef, which has since died down, but has now come back. And one of the things that has led to it coming back is a statement that Jay-Z has made, and basically it's a long statement, and I won't get into the whole thing, and unfortunately I don't want to kind of take his statement out of context. But basically what he said was, when Harry Belafonte said that they need to be more active and do more things and things of that sort, and JC basically responded by saying that his presence is charity. And people only heard that buzz line, and they wanted to attack him. I somewhat understand what he means, because what he was saying was he compared himself to the president by saying that people gonna come out because he's there. Mm-hmm. And so people may show up because he's there. So in a sense, it is somewhat charity, because all he got to do is show up and people show up, and people took exception to it. But basically what I want to kind of talk about in this particular point of this what the hell is the fact that you've got a legend who needs no introduction in the world of civil rights. If you look at a lot of the film from the 60s, you saw Harry Belafonte standing right next to Martin Luther King. Right. There's a very, very famous photograph of him sitting next to Coretta Scott King at Martin Luther King's funeral. The two of them, both of them, you know, silently weeping with dignity. You know, and this is someone who has always been in the middle. If you think about his song, Deo, like, people laugh, Deo, people laugh, they sing it on the cruise ship, Deo, Deo, You know what? Listen to the lyrics. Midnight come and they won't go home. Mm-hmm. You know what he's talking about? Mm-hmm. He's talking about labor unions. He's talking about how they working us to death and we don't get to go home. That's what he's talking about in that song. Okay? So we're talking about social activism is in this man's DNA, who calls out a guy. And don't get me in the interest of full disclosure, I'm a hip hop head. I've been a hip hop head my entire life. And I spent a lot of money on Jay-Z over the years. But this is someone who, by his own admission, was a teenage crack dealer who had skills on the mic, who started rapping about selling crack and made his fortune talking about the denigration of our people. Now he's ascended beyond that. He has ascended to a place where he runs multi-million dollar companies and has, you know, Donald Trump in his Rolodex, and, you know, has meetings, you know, with billionaires and things of that sort. And when he put out Magna Carta Holy Grail, in my mind, and it's unfair for me to feel this way towards Jay-Z, but in my mind, I was convinced that he would do something with this record. Mm-hmm. When Magna Carta Holy Grail came out, I'm like, yo, this cat ascended to a level that he is got to be so far above selling crack that he ain't going to talk about it in his record. I know he not going to talk about it. And then when I listened to it, every other word, the first song started with N, mm-hmm. and he's still talking about the same stuff.
The same stuff.
The mm-hmm. same stuff. You know, like when you were young, a hungry young crack dealer, and that's all you know, then I understand that's what you talk about. But, you know, you vacation in Cabo, dude. Like, really? So I want to start with Carlton on this one. We talking about an old guy and a young guy, you know, intergenerational beef. What's your thoughts on that setup?
At this point in Harry Belafonte's life, he's trying to continue his legacy and get somebody to continue the fights and the disclosures and not disclosure. Basically carry on what he's been doing for, what, 60, 70, 80 years now. He's trying to make sure that tomorrow's leaders are recognized today and they see some of the same things that he's actually fought and conquered, and that nobody forgets them. So, you know, I'm feeling Harry. Harry has been here forever. So let's do it, Harry. Get your man on.
Steven, I know you had told me before that you had a lot of thoughts. I'm gonna come to you. Sure. I'm gonna let you precede me, April. What's your thoughts on this thing?
I understand what Harry Belafonte, where Harry Belafonte is coming from, and I think it's just it's a classic example of how far the generational gap is. How far the generational gap is, particularly in Black communities, because I myself sometimes forget that my father grew up in segregated United States of America. You know, the Civil Rights Bill was, what, 64? By then he was 20, you know? So even though I'm only one generation removed, I forget, because I grew up not with everything, but with things he didn't have or he didn't have access to. So for me, it's easy to kind of lay back, put up my feet, and work is done. I'm good, you know? And I do agree with Carlton that he is, that Harry Belafonte, and Bill Cosby as well. I kind of see Bill Cosby in that light, as trying to wake people up and get them motivated, get us, I should say, motivated and going. And at the same time, I also feel like if Harry Belafonte is calling me out on something, I'm just going to take it and sit down, because that's my elder and I owe you that respect. You know, I don't have to respond to you necessarily. My response may be, you know, let me get up and do something, or let me sit down and be quiet and take it, you know. But it's kind of like, you know, you're being corrected by an elder, and you just, yes, sir.
Show a little bit of respect.
Yeah, yes, sir. We're getting ahead
on the MixLR pick.
Right, bend over. Yeah, I didn't want to say that, but yeah, bend over and take it.
We're getting ahead on the MixLR page. Joey's still listening to us. She says she's going to try to eliminate watching some of these reality shows. Try, but Housewives of Atlanta soap operas will be the exception. We don't act like that for real, and it's sad. Which I agree with. You know, I'm not going to tell someone what they should watch and what they shouldn't watch. However, if you have a problem with what you're seeing, then you need to stop. And also right. keep in mind, particularly as we begin to age and mature in our thought processes, you know, we have to be mindful of the images that our children see. Mm-hmm. And while I enjoy watching Flavor of Love when it came on 10 years ago, I'm at a point in my life where I don't want my daughter to see me watching a show where, you know, 15 girls try to date one dude.
Right.
You know, because, you know, that's just, that to me is not cool. I don't want her to see me, you know, watching a show where, you know, the sister is screaming at the sister, calling her all kinds of names, throwing her chairs at her and all of that kind of stuff under the guise of reality.
Right.
You know, I know that people take exception when I say this, you know, but for me, it really is about that word reality. If we're watching fictional things, then for me, it's different. But if we're watching something under the guise of reality TV, I can't do it. Steven, you have some opinions on this? What you got, man?
Yes. First of all, I think when has it become taboo in our culture that when somebody, even if you're not a leader such as ourselves or anything else in terms of general population, that when someone's trying to correct you or just show you a different way of doing things, it's become taboo that we're not allowed to criticize our own and encourage you. He's not beating them down. He's encouraging them. And I'll give you a situation. A couple of years ago back, Jay-Z tried to open up a 40-40 club in Atlanta Airport. He got ticked off that everybody opens and he won't let the black man. But my thing was this, okay, take this, instead of opening up clubs and other things, this stereotype and what have you, do something positive. How many black-owned aeronautics programs we have out there? Zero. So you could have took this opportunity, we could have built black flight engineers, astrophysicists, all these other different things dealing with flight. And then now you built something. Then I would have had something for you. And it's like when you're, to me, I call these rappers in modern day Anita Browns. So you make your money off the black community or any community, but then you say, oh, I'm giving back out, but you're still saying the same thing. So it's like a drug dealer. You're making money off the drugs, but you're going to feed it back into the community. You're not helping anything because you're repeating the cycle. And I just feel that these artists, because we've had it similar to what you're saying, not you per se, but we've had it so good that they forgot to a point, they forgot to fight and struggle, and it's not done. So now when we have the Trayvon Martins, the Oscar Grants, or any other major social issue, now we want to cry foul. But if you would have kept on fight from mid 85 on, maybe the situations would not have happened. I can't predict the future or what will have happened, but I'm willing to bet if we kept the fight,
right,
you know, like NAACP is fighting for marijuana versus all the other different things that's more important, despite whatever people's view on marijuana. But it's the aspect of, we got so many other different things about not graduating, not money for schools, all these other different things, and this is what you're leading on?
No, I can dig it. And, you know, while we're talking about the intergenerational beef between Harry Belafonte and Jay-Z, Sean Carter, I mean, I said my piece on it. You know, to, you know, I am disappointed that someone that has ascended to his level chooses to not make some minor tweaks to his music because the talent is there. The flip side of that is you do have a rapper who has attained a certain level of prominence in the game, who has decided to make some tweaks to his image, and lo and behold, his record company has a problem with it. T.I., Clifford Harris, T.I. says the record label Atlantic Records hates his new positive image. Of course, he's an Atlanta-based rapper, and I'm getting this from blacklikemoi.com. Atlanta-based rapper built his reputation on hardcore, drug-pushing, Southern King-type lyrics and persona. And his problems is well-documented, you know, with you know, the prison time, the guns, and all of that kind of stuff. We ain't got to get into all of that. But the fact of the matter is he has a TV show with his wife and his children on one of – it's a reality show, and it's positive, and it's always positive images. And you see him as a black man loving his children, spending time with his children and loving his wife and all of those kinds of things. And he apparently, Atlantic Records, which is his record company, hates it. Labels love hardcore T.I. That keeps the cash register ringing. They don't want me to go to prison and get caught, though. They want me to be the Teflon Don, so I can't blame them, is his actual quote, which is interesting. He continues to say that stuff ain't sexy, not actual word, but I'm older, wiser, man. I'm wiser, I'm calmer, I'm better, I'm stronger, and I'm ready for whatever tomorrow is coming. Now, this kind of speaks to what I talked about, that meeting, again, and the images. And in an earlier segment, I mentioned it, I will come back to this. The fact of the matter is, the people who, this record label, you know, they are aware that the kids are going to soak up no matter what certain people say. And so we don't want those people showing any kind of positivity because that's not going to benefit them. You know, you can do some homework and you can check your paper trails, but I would be willing to bet that the people who own these record labels, you know, probably have some kind of money in some of these private prisons. Why? Because if you are constantly hearing kill a guy, kill a guy, kill a guy, slap a girl, slap a girl, slap a girl, eventually you're going to do what? You're going to kill a guy, and slap a girl, slap a girl. And when you do that, your ass going to get arrested. And when your ass get arrested, you're going to go to some of these private prisons. Now, I don't have it documented, but I'm sure that if we did homework, we can find some sort of connect to all of this. Because this is what came out in those meetings. Because it wasn't just record execs there. It was all kinds of people, allegedly, if this meeting really did take place, and no one knows for sure if it really did. But in theory, you know, those of us who've been around long enough to watch the evolution of hip hop can remember the shift. And that shift happened right around the very early 90s, 90, 91, 92. And allegedly this meeting happened in the summer of 1991. So when you see a record company who appears to not be happy with one of their biggest stars, who's making a shift from basically misogyny and crime to fatherhood and love and happiness, and they're unhappy because it doesn't keep with the doctrine that they had set forth. Very interesting to me. What you guys think? Let's round table. April P, you in this on you in on this one first?
It's interesting but not surprising. I would like to see what he does if he decides to stay with the record company or if he decides to leave the record company. Maybe have his own label or something like that.
Well, here's the thing, but not to cut you off, but let me just put this out there. You know, when we mentioned that, you know, a lot of rappers have their own record companies. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of rappers have their own record companies. But guess what? They're distributed by who? The big white.
The major companies.
Exactly. So, okay, you know, you can have, you know, No Limit Records and Death Row Records. But guess who distributed both of them? Interscope Records. You know what I'm saying? Go back and go back and look at the Chronic and make them say and tell me I'm wrong.
That's true.
You know what I'm saying? Go look at the CD jacket. I didn't even cut you off.
No, you're fine.
But you made a good point. I wanted to make sure that we got in on that. Carlton Banks, let's get you in here. You know, you see, I don't know if you watch the show. I don't. I like T.I. I just never took time to watch the show. But he is contending that his record label ain't feeling him because he's moving on and growing up, becoming more mature, and ain't trying to do that craziness in his music anymore. What's your thoughts?
Did they say the same thing about Ice Cube when he matriculated from a hardcore rapper to, you know, everyday mainstream almost?
I don't know that it came out where anybody said anything. However, when's the last time that Ice Cube put a record out that anybody wanted to hear?
Well, because I mean, I'm not saying that.
Music, which it did, began to shift his relevance. Even Ice Cube began to shift.
But that's what I'm saying. Did anybody complain? I mean, Ice Cube, Ice-T, Jay-Z, Snoop, all of them, Dr. Dre, all of them started one way, but they changed and moved to another way, another form. So why not? Why is he catching the brunt of it if that's the case? It's not fair. That's the whole thing I'm saying. It's not fair. He should be able to make the same changes and upgrades and maturity of his level. He shouldn't have to be criticized like everybody else is being criticized.
Steven, what's your thoughts?
I think it's just whereas as long as you this is not the first time it's happened. You see Hammer went through this situation, a bunch of other rappers back in the day, and then even now. I think the focus is just that as long as we continue to support them into this positive way, and you have enough of artists who are doing this, then mm-hmm. I think the record labels will come. Because if you want to do it, sign your belief by the cash you spent. So does, if you believe in this, and if T.I., now the one thing I want to see in T.I. is, if you're making this shift and things like that, are you still going to perform your old hits that's talk about the misogyny and things like that? I want you to cut it off. If you make any money from this, from your old records, give it, do something else with it. But like, you make yourself known by the legacy that you have now for the maturity that he's showing. I'll give him all my support in the world if he's doing that.
I have seen clips of the show. And on the show, he's very involved with his family. He's very much a leader. You know, he's calling family meetings. He's telling the kids, get off the electronics, go outside. We're doing, you know, he's trying to pull everyone together. And, you know, on one clip of the show, he opens up the show and he says, you know, I'm telling you, I've been arrested. I've gone to jail. We're not talking about it anymore. I'm moving on, you know. And at some point, I would like to see if his lyrics follow that route. I haven't heard any of his music recently, so I don't know. But I would love to see if his music follows that route.
Yeah, I'm not sure that we will see him doing what Steven just suggested. While I understand the spirit of what he was saying, I don't think that it's going to happen, one. And two, I'm not sure that I would ask him to do that, even though it's a very interesting request. But the fact of the matter is, you know, he is feeling some kind of way about his label, his label, and the direction he's taking.
And he should, because they're trying to keep him bridled, immature, and under their control. And that's not
interesting enough. You got legendary rapper DMC from Run DMC, who basically came out recently and said what a lot of us have been thinking. Jay-Z and Lil Wayne are not as great as some would think they are because folks are brainwashed. And the quote goes like this: Lil Wayne and Jay-Z ain't hot. It's just people are programmed. So and many people are brainwashed into believing so. That's essentially that essentially says it. I mean, I'm not sure that I agree specifically with them not being good, but the fact of the matter is people are absolutely brainwashed
and watered down. And, like, the hip hop lyrics we have now are so watered down. You know, I sometimes go through my timeline on Facebook and people are putting old songs up, you know, Brand Nubian, groups like that, and you forget how great those lyrics were.
He actually makes a quote, and this is almost similar to what I was saying. Quote, it was inevitable that hip-hop became commercialized, but along the way, our power got taken away. Now you got the same 12 records on the radio being played over and over and over again. I'm like, word. Right. Because I think that it was important that someone that's in the game actually said it instead of someone like me who is a hip hopper to the core, who doesn't even listen to the music of my youth anymore because I can't take it.
You know,
some folks want to say, oh man, you just Asian, you know. No. And there are people that you can go and listen to, and I understand that. I've been given some names. I haven't investigated them because I just choose not to, but It's very interesting to me to see a pioneer of the game be the one to come out and say, you know what, this ain't as great as y'all think it is. Y'all brainwashed into believing it, and I need y'all to know that. That's a pioneer. Steven, what's your thoughts?
Yeah, and I think it's also the fact that it's showing that he's learning how to respect people, because I think it's got comfortable in the community to be disrespectful to others. Thus, like you see, when we mentioned it before, Jay-Z, the lyrics that he used, the words he used to address Harry Belafonte, not only he disagreed, but he was very distasteful and very disrespectful, cursing and said, yo, step back, it's my time now. All these other different things. This is not a drug game. This is not a gang war. But you try to bring Harry Belafonte down to a level of a gang, a drug fight, and that shows you to me that he hasn't learned anything, because he got to a level, and I think they mistaken individual success for the whole overall of the country, of the everybody's success, and that's where the problem comes.
I can dig it. Ain't no half step on Marcus J. Live from the den, LegacyInternetRadio.com. We're getting ready to take our final break of the night, and when we come back, we're going to have our rants, and we're going to have our closings, and we got a special tribute at the end of the show. Ain't no half step on Marcus J. Be back in a few minutes.